Shalom, giving all praise to the Heavenly Father, Yahweh, Bahasham, Yahweh Shai, Bahasham, Racha HaKodash. Double honors to the apostles and elders at Great Millstone who rule well. And as always, we give peace and salutation to the elect. And wanted to further edify on John the Baptist. The apostles and elders and various brothers have done videos driving the point home. And I just wanted to continue in that stead. To further edify the sheep of the house of Israel who have ears to hear. Now, dealing with John the Baptist, he had a very, very important role in which if he didn't fulfill his lot, we wouldn't have this platform that we have today. If he didn't come in this time as well, we wouldn't have this platform that we have today. As we understand, he was prophesied and promised to come and restore all things. Okay, now, as I said, when we read here in Luke, this is roughly 400 years after he was prophesied to come in the book of Malachi. Okay, this is Malachi chapter 4, and I'll start at 5. It says, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord." Okay, and he did come. Okay, he came in the form of John the Baptist, and in these times he came in the form of Abba Bivens. And what was his role? His role, "And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse." He's also prophesied here in the third chapter, "Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his people," okay, through Yahweh Shai, which would gather the elect, even the messenger of the covenant, okay, "in whom ye delight. Behold, he shall come, saith Yahweh, the Lord of hosts." Okay, and that starts with John the Baptist, who was a messenger of Yahweh Shai to come, who would bring you the new covenant. Okay, now it's very, very important to understand that the name John, okay, the name John means grace. As a matter of fact, let's get that real quick. Let's get that real quick. Okay. In Luke 1 and 13, he said, "Thou shalt call his name John." And the angel gave him that name. And what does John mean? Okay. Yahweh's grace, basically. Okay. In which the grace period is which we were given through the Spirit before we were ushered in to the new covenant. And the grace period is a point where you're not solely judged directly by the law as you were in the first covenant. Okay, now let's go ahead and get it in the Hebrew. All right. Yahanan. 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 Okay. Yahweh has graced, and he's given us this grace period, okay, in order for us to not solely be judged by the law, okay, so that we can get ourselves together in preparation and offer up our bodies as a living sacrifice, that the Lord may know our integrity. Because remember, the first covenant was done away with, okay? And how were we brought back to the Heavenly Father in the first covenant? It was through the high priest after the order of Aaron to offer up those sacrifices, okay, to bring us back to the Heavenly Father. And then yearly, they would enter into the holies of holies, all right, on the Day of Atonement, and offer up sacrifice for their own sins and then for the sins of the nation. This is how we were brought back to the Heavenly Father, okay? But the first covenant was done away with. The Heavenly Father did away with our sacrifices, man, okay? And then we understand that according to Jeremiah 31, all right, and various other scriptures, there's a second covenant promised, okay? The question is, who is the high priest of that second covenant? And this is where, the dialogue and, the presence of John the Baptist dealing with Yahweh Shai is very, very important in understanding. Okay. Now we understand that John's name, all right, means grace. Now we're going to go back to Luke 1, but before we go there, let's get Romans 11 and 5. It says, "Even so, at this present time, there is also, all right, there also is a remnant according to the election of grace. Okay, let's look up this word grace. Okay. Okay, grace, kares, okay, it says grace, that which affords joy, pleasure, delightness, sweetness, charm, lovingness, goodwill, love, kindness, favor of the merciful kindness, which God, exerting his holy influence upon soul, turned them to the Messiah. Okay, and who was at the forefront of turning souls to the Messiah at the time? Of John the Baptist. Okay, John the Baptist. Okay, and you can continue reading that benefit, you know, affection, you know, basically, because in this grace period, you know, we're allotted a chance to offer up our bodies as a living sacrifice. Okay, and it's no more of works, because under the first covenant, okay, there were particular things you had to do. You had to keep the laws perfectly. If you went off, you would have to offer up animal sacrifice and so forth, man. Okay, but under this grace period, okay, by us offering up our bodies as a living sacrifice, okay, and following after the Spirit, we can be accepted back to the Heavenly Father by Yahawashi, who is our high priest in the heavens. It says, if by grace, then it is no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it be of works, then it is no more of grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. What then? Israel have not obtained that which he seeketh for, but the election have obtained it, and the rest were blinded. And the rest were blinded because they were denying Yahawashi, okay? Those of the circumcision who did not repent and come back to the Heavenly Father, okay, through the preaching of the Messiah, which started with John. Now, going back to Luke, the first chapter, we're going to start at the fifth verse. Now, we have to understand that we're living in a time, and we're looking at a time here, rather, we're looking at a time here where the Israelites had been beaten down, okay? Now, from the time of Malachi to the time of Luke, okay, you would have to read the Apocrypha to get the history and understanding on what happened with the Israelites from that point going forward. Okay, we had rebuilt the temple at the time of Malachi, but the priest got lazy, and this was Malachi was pretty much cursing him out. Okay, then you had the Greeks come, who eventually would destroy the temple, you know, set up altars of offering swine and all of those things. Then you had particular of our forefathers who would fight to keep the temple. You know, and then leading all the way up to the Romans, okay, Judea was a province of the Roman Empire, okay? Now, you have to understand there's various prophecies of a Messiah to come, okay? And as we read in Malachi, there's prophecy of Elijah, which would be John the Baptist to come, okay? And the Messiah himself told you that John was Elijah the prophet. Let's get that real quick. This is Matthew 11:13. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. Okay, meaning all the prophets and the law spoke of the Messiah to come. Okay, we can go to various prophecies that would speak, okay, of the Messiah to come. All right, Isaiah, we can go to the Genesis, we can go to Numbers, we can go to various prophecies. Okay, we can go to the law itself, the Torah itself, and it speaks of the Messiah to come. All right, all the way until John, okay, which John prophesied and preached that the Messiah would come, okay, and spiritually do what he was doing carnally. And what was he doing? He was baptizing. And it's very, very important to understand that he was a direct descendant of Aaron, and we'll get into that. Okay, for all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if ye will receive it, this is Elijah, which was for to come. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. So he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Okay, and this is only for those who have ears to hear, man, because this is some high level knowledge, man. Okay, now going back to Luke, the first chapter, okay? As I said, we're living at a time where you had different sects, okay? Sects, all right? S-E-C-T-S, which are camps, okay? Who were, you know, very, very stringent in the law, okay? And Lord willing, I could do a lesson on the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, these different sects, which were basically around, okay, keeping the temple, all right? And a lot of them had sold out to the Roman Empire, man, okay? So you at this time, you had a lot of people who were very, very stringent and very tedious about the law, okay? And this is how you would be brought back to the Heavenly Father, which is what the temple represented, okay? And what did you have in the temple? You had the Ark of the Covenant, you had the Holy of the Holies, and the high priest would go offer up sacrifice and do all of these things, all right? So here we go in Luke 1:5, okay? There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, because Herod, what did he call himself? He called himself the king of the Jews, okay? And he was an Edomite. This is basically Esau trying to get that blessing back, okay? The king of Judea, a certain priest, okay? A certain priest named Zechariah of the course of Abijah. Now, who was Abijah? This is 1 Chronicles 24:10, all right? The 7th to Hazak, the 8th to Abijah, okay? And Abijah was one of the sons of Aaron, all right? Now, Abijah was one of the priests who was set up directly by David, okay, when he was setting up basically his choir, which was the first thing he did when he became anointed king, okay? He was king 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem, okay? And as you read here, 1 Chronicles 24:1, now these are the division of the sons of Aaron, okay? The sons of Aaron, Nadab, and it goes down, Eleazar, and so forth, all right? Which, who's Aaron, okay? If you're an Israelite, you should very well understand who Aaron was, okay? Ah-Rawan, all right? What does that mean? Light bringer, okay? This is the true light, the knowledge, wisdom, and understanding of the scriptures, okay? It says, Aaron, the elder brother of Moses, consecrated, meaning set apart, high priest by his brother. You can read that in Exodus 29. Basically, he was the high priest, okay? And you can read that history and get that understanding. But Moses and then Aaron and his sons, okay, were the priest which were over giving the covenant, okay, to the nation of Israel, man. And Aaron and his sons had the duties of the temple in offering up those sacrifices, man, okay? Which is very, very important as concerning to the nation of Israel, which as we're reading here in Luke, the first chapter, you still had various Israelites. You had Judah, Benjamin, and Levi here mainly, who were still in that mind frame of that first covenant of the temple, all right? But as we read in prophecy, we know that there's one greater to come, all right, a high priest after the order of Melchizedek, which would bring us everlasting life, okay? The sacrifices that Aaron, okay, and his sons offered did not bring us everlasting life, which is another thing dealing with you Old Testament Torah-only Israelites, okay? Who's the high priest of the Second Covenant, okay? What is the role of Melchizedek? We'll get into that in just a minute, okay? Going back, there was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zechariah of the course of Abijah, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth, okay? So both Zechariah, John's father, and his wife, Elizabeth, were descendants of Aaron, okay? In some shape, form, or fashion, okay? And that's very, very important in understanding the role of John the Baptist, okay? It says, and they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless, okay? Because this, remember, was your way to being accepted back to the Heavenly Father in that first covenant, okay? And they had no child because Elizabeth was barren and now well stricken in years. Okay, and the Heavenly Father timed the birth of John the Baptist perfectly, all right, to be right at the forefront of preaching before the Messiah. Okay, now as we go down, verse 8, it says, and it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, this is speaking of Zechariah, John the Baptist's father, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he was in the temple of the Lord, okay, which was a lot that goes back to Aaron. Exodus 30:7, and Aaron shall burn thereon sweet incense every morning. When he dresseth the lamps, he shall burn incense on it. And when Aaron lighteth the lamps at evening, he shall burn incense upon it, a perpetual incense before Yahweh throughout your generations. And you shall offer no strange incense, which a few of Aaron's sons eventually did and were put to death. Okay? So it's a very, very tedious office, which Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, all right, was in that order. This is 1 Chronicles 6:49. But Aaron and his sons offered upon the altar of the burnt offering and the altar of incense and were appointed for all the work of the place of the most holy, okay, the holy of holies in the temple, and to make an atonement for Israel, okay, according to all that Moses, the servant of God, had commanded them, okay? So this is very, very important in understanding that John the Baptist was born in that order. He is a direct descendant of the high priest Aaron. Okay? So as we continue reading, let's see here. We'll read all the way. Let's see here. And then the angel came. Verse 9, it says, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense, okay? Meaning they were dedicated to that temple, man, okay? And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing at the right hand of the altar of incense. Oh, man, beautiful. And when Zechariah saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, fear not, Zechariah, for thy prayer is heard. And what was he praying for? He was praying to have a child because they were getting old, okay? And thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name Yochanan, okay? He's going to be the one, okay, at the forefront of preaching the Messiah, man, that grace that we would need in order to be accepted into that new covenant under our new high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Okay, it says, and they shall have, and thou shall have joy and gladness, and shall, and many shall rejoice at his birth, because he was prophesied to come. Okay, he is one of the followers of the Messiah. Now this is a quick point. You know, the followers of the Messiah did not just start following the Messiah as they came on the earth here in the New Testament. The followers of the Messiah, let's get this real quick. Revelation, the 14th chapter, okay? And it speaks of those who have the new song, okay? And John was one of those messengers, man, okay? He had his particular lot, okay? Now, he wasn't one of the 12, all right? He wasn't the direct follower of the Messiah in that time, but he had his lot and his role, which was to prepare the way, okay, and turn the hearts of the children to the fathers and the hearts of the fathers to the children, man. Without him doing what he did, we don't have this platform, man. And remember, at the time that John the Baptist was on the scene, all right, alliance with that first covenant was heavily upon the minds of our people. Now, real quick, some insight real quick on Abba Bivens, who was Elijah the prophet, John the Baptist coming in this time, you know, at the forefront of our preaching. At the time that there was many who were teaching the Torah, the commandment keepers, the commandments, you know, Abba Bivens was the first to come with the true message, bringing in the Messiah, okay? Also adding the New Testament, okay? Because that was John the Baptist all over again, man. And from that point, all the way up to this point, we have this platform, man, in which this truth has grown, okay, to what it is. But without him coming and restoring all things, we would not have this platform. The Lord does everything in his proper order. This is Revelation 14 and 4, speaking of the elect. These are they which were not defiled with women. And as you start at the top, Revelation 14 and 1, and I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Sion, and with him 144,000 having his father's name written in their forehead. This is Yahweh Shai, all right, and the elect, all right, the governing body, okay? And as you read down, okay, meaning they from the foundation of the earth, the Father's name was written in their heads, man, okay? They were chosen from the foundation of the earth to be sealed with the knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, okay, to overcome this devil, okay, to overcome wickedness, okay? And they have the new song, okay? And in their different incarnations, they've come on the earth to do mighty works in the name of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai, man, okay? And it says, these are they which are not defiled with women, for lo, they are virgins. Okay, meaning they would not be penetrated, okay, and ultimately destroyed fully by sin. Okay, the Lord hath chosen them to keep them to be perfected, man. Okay, these are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and unto the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Okay? In their mouth is found no guile. There is 144,000 of them, and John the Baptist is one of those men. So he was a follower of Yahweh Shai from the foundation of the earth. Okay? You don't just become a follower of the Messiah starting in the New Testament. Okay? Now, according to your lot and your order, you're going to do what you do as you come onto the earth. But if you're of that number, you're of that number, man. And this is what ISUPK failed to realize, which is why we're calling them to repent and stop teaching that madness before the Lord destroys them, man. Okay? Now, this is also Isaiah 8 and 18, which Paul quoted this in Hebrews, the first chapter. Okay? I start at 16. Bind up the testimony and seal the law among my disciples. Okay? Now, let's look up this word disciple. All right, Lama Wad. Okay, taught, learned, disciple, taught, accustomed to something. Okay, learned. Okay, like Enoch meant learned man. Okay, dedicated. Okay, these are the ones who are taught and disciplined in the word of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai, man. They didn't just become disciples at the time of Yahweh Shai as well, man. Okay. They were disciples from the foundation of the earth. And I will wait upon Yahweh that hideth his face from the house of Jacob, and I will look for him. Behold, I and the children whom Yahweh have given me are for signs and wonders in Israel from Yahweh, the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth in Mount Zion. Him in the 144,000, man. So these children whom the Lord has given to Yahweh Shai are sent for signs and wonders in Israel, and John the Baptist is one of those children, which is why it says many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, because he took the vow of a Nazarite. And he shall be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. Okay, showing you he's one of the elect. He was chosen from the foundation of the earth. Before he was formed in the belly, he was known of the Heavenly Father, man. Okay? But Zechariah and Elizabeth were vessels chosen to bring this child forth. Okay? And they happen to be direct descendants of Aaron, man. Which is very, very important in understanding John the Baptist's lot and role, man. In the transferring of the priesthood to Yahweh Shai. Okay? Melchizedek, the greater priesthood, in which the sacrifice offered will bring us eternal life, not as the sacrifices that were done by Aaron and his sons. They didn't bring us eternal life. which is we're getting the book of Hebrews. That's the understanding in that book that you need to come to grips with. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. And he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. So out of all of these, commandment keepers and out of all of these temple, keepers and all of these Israelites who were faithful to that first covenant to the best of their ability, as the Lord said, these two in particular, Elizabeth and Zechariah were blameless. Okay, you have John the Baptist who comes on the scene. And what is his job to do? To turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, meaning the understanding of Yahawashah, the understanding of the upgraded priesthood and covenant. Okay? Okay, and to give us grace to where we can prepare ourselves to be welcomed into that second covenant, to make ready a people, all right, prepared for the Lord. Okay, and then you can go down and we'll go back to that now, and we'll come back to this we'll come back to this chapter, Lord willing, to end it off. Now this is Matthew, the third chapter. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent, okay, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Okay, the true followers of the Messiah. Okay. Repent. Okay. Turn ye to Yahawashi. Okay, who is going to be your high priest, which many of those at that time denied. Okay, they understood that John was a great man. They understood that Yahawashi may have been a prophet, but they didn't want to associate him with the Messiah to come, man. And a lot of them didn't want to associate John the Baptist with Elijah, who was to come, man. So there was a lot of friction, okay, and hell that these men caught from those niggas who did not want to turn back and repent, okay? For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, okay, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, all right, make his path straight. Okay, which is the same thing we're doing. Okay, we're preparing the way of the Lord, making his path straight. We're telling our people to repent. Okay, but at the forefront of our office was John the Baptist. Okay, it says, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, and you can get that prophecy in Isaiah the 40th chapter. Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle. All right. Now, the interesting thing about this leather girdle, real quick, is Elijah, 2 Kings 1:8. And they answered him, he was a hairy man and girt with a girdle of leather about his loins. And he said, it is Elijah the Tishbite. Okay. There you go. It's showing you that's the same guy coming back, man. Okay. This is Elijah. Okay. It's showing you reincarnation exists in the Bible, man. All right. But going back, and the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey, meaning he didn't care about the, this world. He was not of this world. He separated himself and went into the wilderness, which a lot of prophets would do, all right, to grow in the grace and glory of Yahweh Bashem Yahushai, man. Okay, it says, and then went out him to Jerusalem, okay, and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. Now these are all Israelites, man. Okay, what did the scripture say? Many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. Okay. Verse 16, Luke 1:16. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. So as you're reading about this baptizing, he's baptizing Israelites. Okay. And the whole time he's baptizing, he's preaching of the Messiah to come, which we'll show you. Okay. Now, this baptism is symbolic of what Yahawashi is going to do spiritually, just as the law, okay, the tabernacle that was built by Moses, the tabernacle that was built by Solomon, okay, which, where did he get the blueprint from? David, his father, all right, which is Moses, but that's another lesson for another time. Okay, Moses, you know, he was given the blueprint on how to build the tabernacle. He built it, all right. Then Aaron, you know, and his sons would eventually be the keepers of that temple and offered up the sacrifices and so forth. And this is how the children of Israel were joined, all right, to that first covenant. But there's a second covenant in which everything that was done under the first covenant was just a sign of what would happen spiritually under the second covenant. But there's a high priest of the second covenant, okay? And that high priest is Yahawashi, who the world ignorantly calls Jesus Christ, man, Melchizedek, okay, who was anointed high priest by the Most High God himself, man, in the heavens, and we'll get that, okay? But when he saw, okay, and they were baptized confessing their sins, man, okay, because though you had a lot of those who were, you know, the law this, the law that, okay, man, you had particular sects that they would, you know, make laws on top of the law. They would go into the letter of the law and say, well, you got to do this, you got to do that, based upon the wording of the words in the law, because each Hebrew character has a meaning. So they would make a law based upon the character, meaning it was so tedious that it was stressing people the hell out, man. These high priests were losing their damn minds. So what did the Lord do? He sent one directly from the descendants of Aaron, okay, to preach Yahawashi, man, which is very, very humbling, because John the Baptist could have came and boasted in that first covenant, man. But we're going to read and see what he did, okay? And this is where he curses out the, you know, the Pharisees and Sadducees, which were sects, all right, who came to the baptism, and they came basically to see what's going on and, you know, scoff. The same thing the scoffers do when they come to our videos. What did he tell them? But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Now, the Pharisees and the Sadducees were of those camps and sects that I told you that were around, all right, keeping the temple, okay? They were very, very stringent and tedious in the law. So what did he say? O generation of vipers, he knew they were wicked. Who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Meaning your ass is going to be destroyed. You're not going to accept the Messiah. You're not even going to accept me. You don't believe in the truth, man. You believe in your position. You believe in the praises of men and all of the things that those wicked guys believed in. It says, bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance, man. Okay? Now, as you keep going down, what did he say? I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, okay, which was symbolic of what? But he that cometh after is me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He's letting you know I'm not the Messiah, because there was a lot of questions going on of who he was. But he himself told you, I'm not that guy that's going to bring you everlasting life. Okay, what I'm doing is only symbolic, just as with Aaron, okay, what Moses, what all of them did was only symbolic of something that was already in the heavens. You see? So John the Baptist is telling you that, okay? He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire, okay? Whose fan is in his hand, and this word fan is basically, it means shovel. As a matter of fact, let's look it up. I remember looking that up a while back, but this word, fan is not like literally a fan that, you know, like I have one blowing on me right now. This is speaking of a shovel, okay?
Strauss G 4425. Duon.
Duon. Duon, all right. The P is silent. A winnowing shovel. So this goes back to an ancient custom of separating wheat, you know, from chaff or tares, man. Okay, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, okay, and gather his wheat into the garner, and he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire, man. the two-thirds, man. So he's gonna gather the elect, okay? He's the high priest, okay? Then cometh Yahawashi from Galilee to Jordan unto John, okay, to be baptized of him, okay? The Jordan River, all right? Yaradan, that's what the Hebrew word for Jordan is, Yaradan, okay? To be baptized of him, okay? Showing you Yahawashi's humility, okay? And John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and thou comest thou to me? All right? And Yahawashi said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. We have to do this. You have to baptize me, all right, so all righteousness can be fulfilled, man. Okay? Then he suffered him, okay? And Yahawashi, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Basically, this is the high priest, man. So it was basically an upgrading of the priesthood, a transferring of the priesthood to the Messiah, man, which was ordained a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. As a matter of fact, we can get that in the book of Psalms 110, okay? Psalms 110 and 1. The Lord, this is David speaking, the Lord Yahweh said unto my Lord, okay, which we understand is his son, out of his loins came his son, which would eventually be the one to sit on the throne of David and rule the nation of Israel forever. Sit thou at my right hand, okay, which he's in the heavens right now, on the right hand, acting as a high priest, okay, sending down spiritual gifts, okay, unto the elect, okay. Sit down at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. The Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion, rule thou in the midst of thine enemies, which is going to happen under his only begotten son. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power, in the beauty of holiness from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of thy youth. Yahweh have sworn, okay? This is an oath, and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. You see that? Now, those of you who deny Yahawashi, who's this speaking of? Those of you who say it's just the Most High, who's this high priest after the order of Melchizedek? And who is Melchizedek? Real quick. Genesis 14. We'll just get it real quick because I want to go into that in another lesson. But this is Genesis 14 and 18. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, and he was a priest of the Most High God. Now, eventually, when you read down, Abraham, okay, or Abram, before his name was changed to Abraham, before he was known of God, paid tithes to this priest, okay? Showing you that before the Levitical priesthood, there was already a priesthood, but it was based on something that was in the heavens. Melchizedek, all right, which is Yahawashi, the king of Salem, which is Jerusalem, brought forth bread and wine, and he was a priest of the Most High God, man. And Abraham eventually gave him tithes, man. Okay, now this is who this chapter is speaking of, man. Okay, he's gonna strike through kings, he's gonna judge amongst the heathen, okay, and do the duties and fulfill, all right, the will of the Most High Yahweh, man, on the earth. Okay, this is Acts chapter 10. Let's see here. In 34, then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that the Most High is no respecter of persons, man. Okay? Which before Yahawashi was on the scene, it was all about that first covenant. You know, then John came and he gave that understanding, and then it became, you know, through faith in Yahawashai, you be brought back to the Heavenly Father, man, which Yahawashai is our high priest, man. Okay? But the circumcision, those who didn't want to accept of the Messiah, they wanted to make being brought back to the Heavenly Father through that first covenant, man. Okay? And they thought of themselves to be special. Okay? And untouchable. And even denied those Gentiles. Then Peter opened his mouth and said of a truth. Now, this is after Cornelius came on the scene. All right? Which he was extended the mercies of David. Okay? That God is no respecter of persons, but in every nation he that feareth him, okay, who offers up the right sacrifice and worketh righteousness, is accepted with him. Okay, because Israel was scattered amongst these particular nations where Paul would eventually go, okay, and where the disciples were going and preaching this word, man. It wasn't just fixated on Judea and where the temple was, okay. It's wherever the Israelites are who's going to repent and fear the Heavenly Father, man, through faith in Yahawashai, man. You're accepted with him. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Yahawashai, he is Lord of all. So this word is only sent unto the children of Israel. That word I say, ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. How God anointed, because high priest must be anointed. When you read Exodus, the 30th chapter, okay, the sons of Aaron were anointed with a particular oil. All right, that same oil was the oil Solomon was anointed with, man, showing you that he was the high priest, man, because that oil was only supposed to touch the sons of Aaron. All right, but even above that, the Most High anointed Yahawashai of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, all right, for God was with him, okay? The Most High was with Yahawashai, man. He anointed Yahawashai as the high priest, okay? Now, this is John 3 and 23. It says, and John also was baptizing in Enon near to Salem, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized, for John was not yet cast into prison. Now, when John was cast into prison, that would be pretty much the end of his lot. He would curse out Herod, you know, who was a fake Jew, all right, cursed him out for, you know, acting like he's a of the chosen seed. But he was committing adultery. He's basically like, if you of the chosen seed, if you a Jew, why you ain't keeping the law? All right, and eventually he was put to death. The same thing we doing, cursing out these so-called Jews, saying you're not the true Jews. John did that, okay? Yahawashah, he called Herod a fox, man. It was cursing out those the followers of the Messiah were cursing out those Herodians, man. Okay, the Israelites who followed them, because you had Israelites who were Herodians as well, man. Because they followed after those teachings, man, and were sellouts. It says, then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and Jews about purifying, okay? Because what purifies you? Ultimately, the Holy Spirit purifies you. But John was baptizing, which was symbolic of what the Holy Spirit would do. Just as, under the first covenant, those sacrifices purified you. But the sacrifice of Yahawashai will purify you for eternity. Okay? And that's what Hebrews goes into. It says, and they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, all right, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, speaking of Yahawashai, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. Showing you that John was preaching, okay, those to go and follow the Messiah, man. Now, of course, you did have particular of those who only understood and knew about John's baptism, all right? But eventually, those who the Lord wanted to come to the understanding of Yahawashai's baptism would come, man, okay? However they would come. It says, and John answered and said, a man could receive nothing except to be given him from heaven. which he understood that Yahawashi was a high priest anointed in the heavens, man. Ye yourselves bear witness that I said I am not the Messiah, but that I am sent before him. See that? He's the one crying in the wilderness. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom which standeth and heareth him rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This is my joy, therefore, is fulfilled. Okay? He was sent to prophesy of the coming of the Messiah and to prepare the people. That was his course. It was fulfilled. Let's get that in Acts, the 13th chapter. Okay? Acts 13, I believe. Acts 13 and 24, when John had first preached before his coming the baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel, and as John fulfilled his course, he said, whom think ye that I am? I am not he, but behold, there cometh one after me whose shoes of his feet I am not worthy to loose. Okay, and him being a direct descendant of Aaron, that was a very, very humble, all right, statement, being that you had those at that time who were boasting in that first covenant, man. The Lord is cold, man. Okay, so John fulfilled his course, and he understood what his course was. Okay? He said, he must increase, but I must decrease. Now, what does this mean? Okay? John would eventually, you know, go to jail. He would die. But ultimately, this priesthood must increase. Okay? This priesthood will give us eternal life. All right? And that first covenant will be done away with. Okay? He that cometh from above is above all. Remember, Yahawashi is a high priest directly from the heavens, man. He that is of the earth is earthly and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from heaven is above all. Yahawashi is the head of the church. Okay? Let's get that in Colossians. Colossians, the first chapter, in the 18th verse. I start at 17. Okay? Ooh, as a matter of fact, I start at 13. Start at 12, giving thanks unto the Father, which have made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who have delivered us from the power of darkness and have translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Okay? Even the forgiveness of sins, man. Eternally. Okay? Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature, man. Okay? This is Melchizedek, priest of the Most High God. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and by him all things consist. Okay? He's the only begotten Son of the Most High, man. And after that, everything else was created, man, starting with the elect, the first fruits, okay? It says, he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, okay? This is the bishop of our souls, okay? The head of the church, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have preeminence. And John understood that, man. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. Okay? John understood that. John 3 and 30. He must increase, but I must decrease. Okay? He that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from heaven is above all. And he that and what he have seen and heard, he testified, and no man receiveth his testimony. He that have received his testimony have set to his seal that God is true, because they believe that this was the Messiah. They believe that he was Elijah, which was to come and restore all things, man. For he whom God have sent speaketh the words of God, for God giveth the Spirit by measure unto him, man. And the highest measure was given unto Yahawashi, man. But as he said, I and the children whom the Lord have given me, the elect, are sent for signs and wonders. And John was sent for one of those signs and wonders, man. The Father loveth the Son, and have given all things into his hand. And he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. Okay? You're going to be brought back to the Father. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Wow. Okay? So let's get the book of Hebrews 3:1. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Yahawashi HaMashiach. You see that? He's the high priest of our profession, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. Okay? Let's see here. For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses. You have a lot of people boasting in Moses. You have a lot of people boasting in that first covenant. Well, you're not going to get any glory, man. Because that first covenant was done away with. Those sacrifices were done away with. There is a second covenant. Who's the high priest of that second covenant? Who's the mediator of that second covenant? It's Yahawashi, who was accounted of more glory than Moses. Because as Moses built that tabernacle, he built it based on what he saw in the heavens. But there's also a high priest of that tabernacle in the heavens, which is Melchizedek, man. And this is what people don't understand, man. This is an upgraded testament. This is an upgraded covenant. This is an upgraded priesthood. We're going to reign as kings and priests after the order of Melchizedek, not after the order of Aaron, man. We'll get a little bit more on that. All right. And then, Lord willing, we'll go into Hebrews, man, as a series and break this all down, man. Because as, you know, you guys go off, we continue to learn. We learn based on your slip-ups, man. And we gain understanding through the spirit of Yahweh Bashem Yahushai, man. Okay, because there was a high priest, okay, spoken of to come, man. Okay, as a matter of fact, let's get this in Genesis 49. Okay. Genesis, the 49th chapter, man. In the 10th verse, the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet. So the lawgiver will come out of the loins and lineage of Judah through Perez, which is where David would eventually come, man. Okay? So the lawgiver would eventually come from Judah, not Levi. Okay? So a lot of you boasting in that Levitical priesthood, talking about you here to just restore that order, you through, okay? You need to repent, okay? And it's no need to scream and curse at you anymore, because you all bugged out coming onto the comment boards, leaving these long messages. You don't know what to do. That's why you're on our videos, okay? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come. Unto him shall the gathering of the people be. He's going to gather the wheat. Okay? He's that high priest, man. For unto us, Isaiah 9:6, a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government, okay, the Masharah, shall be upon his shoulder. Okay? The government, okay, which is the priesthood, shall be on his shoulder. Remember, Aaron. Okay, Exodus 28:12, and thou shalt put the two stones upon the shoulders of the ephod, which will go on the high priest's shoulder, for the stones of the memorial unto the children of Israel, and Aaron shall bear the names before the Lord upon his two shoulders for a memorial. Okay? So what Aaron did under that first covenant, Yahawashi is going to do under the second in a greater fashion. Aaron's priesthood, Moses' building of the tabernacle, was all based upon what was already being done in the heavens, man. Okay, and that child, which is Yahawashi, would eventually come out of the loins and lineage of David, man. Point blank, period, man. Let's get Hebrews 4:14. Hebrews 4:14. Okay? Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Yahawashah, the Son of God. Okay? Let us hold fast our profession, man. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we all are, okay? Yet without sin. He came in the flesh just like we came in the flesh, man. Okay? Flesh and blood, as it says in Hebrews, the first chapter. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace. All right, and find grace to help in a time of need. And that started with John, man. Okay? That's the you know, grace being brought into this, you know, upgraded priesthood, man. Okay? Let's see here. Let's get Hebrews, the fifth chapter. For every high priest, and Lord willing, I'm going to go through all of these chapters as a series in due time, if the Spirit allows. Because the book of Hebrews was a serious exhortation of the importance of Yahawashi, man. And how this is the priesthood which is going to bring us the glory. Yahawashi, Melchizedek, that's the plug. That's the man. That's the guy. Okay, Moses, Aaron, they were great men. They did great things. All right, and they will even have upgraded, you know, lots in the kingdom. You know, of course, you know, we know and understand that Moses is David, you know, that, you know, just as Moses built that tabernacle, you know, well, the tabernacle of David, okay? You see, but it's going to be under and after the order and the priesthood of Melchizedek. For every high priest taken from among men is ordained for men in things pertaining to God, that he may offer both gift and sacrifices for sins. Who can have compassion on the ignorant and on them that are out of the way, that for that he himself is also compassed with infirmity. Okay? So the high priest of the first covenant, after the order of Aaron, they themselves had sin, man. Okay? And by reason hereof, he ought, as for the people, so also for himself to offer for sins. Okay? And no man taketh this honor unto himself, but he that is called of God, as was Aaron. See that? So also Yahawashah glorified not himself to be made an high priest, but he that saith unto him, thou art my son, to this day I have begotten thee. As he saith also in another place, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Wow. Wow, man. Woo! Verse 9, and being made perfect, he came to the altar of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him, called of God and high priest after the order of Melchizedek, man. Okay? And what does that word order mean? Taxes, arrangement, arranging, order, fixed succession. Because there ain't two high priests in the heaven, there's only one, and that's Yahawashi Melchizedek, man. The king of righteousness, man. Due to right order, orderly condition, post, rank. So he's a priest after the rank of Melchizedek, meaning he is Melchizedek. And that's how you're going to be made a king and a priest. Not after the order of Aaron, man. Okay, let's get a few more. We'll close out Hebrews 9. So that's what John was doing. He was basically saying, this is the man. You know? You know, our lot, you know, served, you know, under that first covenant, that's not going to bring you glory unto everlasting life, as a lot of people believe. John was a very, very humble man, man, and to do what he did and to be determined as he was to fulfill his lot, man, he's a great man and he's of the elect, man, and you guys are going to be destroyed, man, along with them dark shades, okay? Hebrews 9:1. Then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service in a worldly sanctuary, the temple. Okay, starting with this, the tabernacle, going back to Moses. For there was a tabernacle made, the first wherein, which was a candlestick and a table and a showbread, and it's called the sanctuary. And after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all, which had a golden censer, the Ark of the Covenant, overlaid with gold, all right, and a pot that had manna, all right, you remember the bread and wine that Melchizedek had, and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant, and over it the cherubims of the glory shadowing the mercy seat, which is where the Lord spoke to the children of Israel, which cannot now speak particularly. Now, when these things are thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. But into the second with the high priest once every year without blood, not without blood, because you have to have blood, which he offered for himself and for the heirs of the people. You see that? He offered for himself and for the heirs of the people. The Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, man, because that will be done through Yahawashai, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, okay, which was a figure for the time then present in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience. Because after those sacrifices were offered, who knows, a day later, a week later, minutes later, you may sin, you may go off. So that was only a figure of what was to come, man. Okay, it says which was a figure for the time then present, and which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, man. But Yahawashah is going to make our conscience perfect forever, man. The sacrifices in that first covenant did not bring you to everlasting life, man. You will go off the next week, the next day, which stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation. Okay, which John the Baptist, okay, did that washing. He washed you with that water. That was a carnal ordinance imposed on them until the time of reformation. What is reformation? Salaki, I'm going over, but hey, the spirit is on me. Reformation.
Strong's G, 1357. Diathesis. Diathesis.
Okay, in a physical sense, making straight, restoring to its natural and normal condition something in some which in some way protrudes or has got out of line, as a broken or mishappen limbs, man. Okay, and we in sin, okay, we basically were subject unto sin, man, through this flesh. And the time of reformation is when Yahawashah came. Okay, it says, but Hamashiach being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, based on a tabernacle in the heavens not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified the purifying of the to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Hamashiach, who through the eternal spirit offered himself up without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. He's going to purge our conscience. He's going to purge our minds from sin. He's going to write the laws in our inward parts, man. And for this cause, he is the mediator of a new testament, a new covenant, that by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, that they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Man, now I'll go into that in its fullness, Lord willing, in due time. I wanted to get real quick Hebrews 7. Oh, man, Hebrews 7. And 11. Ooh. Lord will, I'll get it all. But for the sake of time, Hebrews 7:11. If therefore perfection whereby the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law. Okay, what further need was there for another priest that should arise after the order of Melchizedek and not after the order of Aaron? Huh? Could any of you guys who deny the the Old Testament explain this? Huh? Who's Melchizedek? I'll jump to verse 26. For such a high priest became us, who was holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needed not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice. Those high priests after what order? The order of Aaron, as John the Baptist was, all right, as his father was, as his mother was, for his own sins first, okay, who needed not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice for his own sins, and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself, all right? He basically came to restore what he did as Adam and as Solomon, because as Adam, we all fell after that sin, and after Solomon, you know, the whole kingdom was split. And from that point, we haven't had a government, man. So he's coming to restore that, what he did. So he had to die for his own sins and for the sins of the people, just as the high priest had to die for their own sins, man. Okay? Because remember, the Lord said in the book of, I'll just say it, 2 Samuel, the 7th chapter, he said, if he sinned, speaking of David's son, he would chasten him with the rod of men. There's no record of Solomon being chastened with the rod of men. That happened when he came as Yehoshua. Okay, as it says in Romans, the 5th chapter. Romans, the 5th chapter. Romans 5 and 14. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, because we fell, and then eventually, all right, we would receive the law to give us that natural order to bring us back to the Father. That's why the Lord set up the priesthood. Adam was the first priest on the earth, okay? Then that was passed down to Abel. But remember, Yahawashi was the first priest in the heavens, okay? It says, from even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who was the figure, okay, of him that was to come. Adam was the figure of him that was to come, which is Yahawashi, man. Okay? Let's see here. That's not the point I wanted. Verse 17. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Yahawashi Hamashiach, man. Okay? Woo! Verse 19, for as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one many shall be made righteous, man. So he's basically coming to restore that which he messed up as Adam and as Solomon, man. Okay, so basically when he offered himself up, okay, he offered himself up first for his own sins, then for the people's. And this is heavy, man. This is for those who have ears. This is meat. Okay? And if you can't receive it, you know, pray for understanding, man. Okay? Because there's a whole hell of a lot we have to go over to bring out this understanding, man. This can't be given in one video, but, you know, Lord willing, through the Spirit, you're understanding what I'm going into. Who needed not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice first for his own sins and then for the people. But this he did once when he offered up himself. For the law maketh men high priests which have infirmity, but the word of oath, going back to Psalms 110, when he said, thou art a priest after the order of Melchizedek, which was since the law, maketh the Son who was consecrated forevermore. And finally, this is Hebrews, the 45th chapter, okay? And I'll just start at the 6th verse and jump down. He exalted Aaron and holy man like unto him, even his brother of the tribe of Levi. An everlasting covenant he made with him and gave him the priesthood among the people. He beautified him with comely ornaments and clothed him with the robe of glory. All right. And he just goes into his order and what he would do. Let's see here. It says, before him, there was none such, neither did ever any stranger put them on, talking about those robes that the high priest wore, but only his children and his children's children perpetually, right? John the Baptist was one of those children. Zacharias, John's father, was one of those children. Their sacrifices shall be wholly consumed every day, twice continually, all right? Until Yahawashai, all right? The reform, restoring all things. But John had to come and do what he did as well. Before that, Moses consecrated him and anointed him with holy oil. Speaking of Aaron, okay, as Yahawashi anointed, as the Most High anointed Yahawashi, all of these things were symbolic. The oil was symbolic, man. Okay? This was appointed to him by an everlasting covenant and to his seed so long as the heavens should remain. So the question is, why was Solomon anointed with that oil? That they would minister unto him and execute the office of the priesthood and bless the people in his name. Okay? He chose out of him, out of all men living, to offer sacrifices to the Lord, incense and a sweet savor for a memorial, to make reconciliation for his people. He gave unto him the commandments and the authority and the statutes of judgments, that he should teach Jacob the testimonies and inform Israel of his laws. Okay, and as you read down, let's see here. But he made Aaron more honorable and gave him an heritage and divided unto him the first fruits of the increase, especially he prepared bread in abundance. Remember, Melchizedek had bread, okay? For they eat the sacrifices of the Lord, which he gave unto him in his seed. Howbeit in the land of the people he had no inheritance, neither he had any portion among the people, for the Lord himself is his portion and his inheritance, because the Levites were set apart for the duties of the Most High, man. Okay? And more importantly, Moses and the sons of Aaron. Okay? And you had other Levites for other lots. Then he goes into Phinehas, the son of Eleazar. All right, and here's the point. Therefore was a covenant of peace made with him, that he should be chief of the sanctuary and of his people, that he and his posterity should have the dignity of the priesthood forever, according to the covenant made with David the son of Jesse of the tribe of Judah, that the inheritance of the king should be to his posterity alone. So the inheritance of Aaron should be unto his seed. The inheritance of Aaron will be unto the seed of David, which is Yahawashi, man, who is the high priest in the heavens, man. God give you wisdom in your heart to judge his people in righteousness, that their good things be not abolished, and that their glory may endure forever, man. And that's going to be through Yahawashi. So hopefully y'all were edified. Till next time, Shalom.